After this morning, as we all, I would also like to change all my presentation to relate to the very interesting issues that have been here, but I have to stick to this one. Conservation and management, we can also ask if they are opposite or do they support each other. But at least there is a need for world heritage tools. Mechtild mentioned the need for best practice, but we also need tools and arguments in the situation. I will have no sheep in my presentation, but some reindeer at the end, at least. And I will link this to when Mikael Telus comes later. There is a World Heritage Capacity Building Strategy, and ICROM is mainly the responsible of training issues within this context. And it does highlight, it's fairly recent from last year, it highlights the integration of natural culture heritage management, a proactive approach, and recognizes three target audiences, of which one is the communities and networks. And I think this is what we have been talking about this morning. So, there is a need for new methods for understanding and mapping immaterial aspects, which are not included in conservation systems, in databases, and in decision-making frameworks. We all know the situation, and talking about this, they say, oh, you're talking. I mean, we also have the European Landscape Convention question about as perceived by people. Do we have means to really convey what the people are thinking in our decision-making systems? I think this is what we also talked about this morning. Also, the landscape processes of today. We had a very interesting view of the changes in Les Causses and Cévennes, but how about the future? World Heritage inscription actually is very proactive. You need to enhance and support and to conserve the value for future generations. And it also asks us about a vision for the future. We solve the problems of today instead of thinking how we can support it in the future. And of course, this includes competencies in, well, we know this, communication, participatory process, conflict management, not the least, and dialogue building. Do we all have this in our training? Do we all have the professional competence in this? I am now doing research in my university about heritage in decision making. And I'm saying, why was this not in my professional training, you know, years ago? Why do I have to do research on this? It should be a tool I could use immediately. And the overall resource management perspective. We're talking about resilience very much today, but it's not a bad word. It's really quite useful. And what is the social ecological resilience? Anything but a culture resilience? I'll be very happy to come back to that, but it will not make it in the 15 minutes. The reflection from recent periodic reporting meetings, I was not in Berlin, but this was in Sibiu and in Kotter and others, also enforced that really the sites do feel that they need more support, they need more muscles to work with these issues we have talked this morning. A comprehensive view on the outstanding units of value and above all shared vision for its development. So we are not always conflict management. We do agree on something as a starting point for management. And the need for coordination systems for the management responsibilities. I think I have heard this all my professional life, that we are all working sectorially. So now working with the living landscapes as we are here, we have to produce this response. We can't just talk about it. And one thing, communication comes in every meeting, and surely comes here. So let's do something. Let's develop mechanisms that work with that. And perhaps one of the most important, also relating to the panel discussion just a while ago, benefit sharing mechanisms. Community involvement doesn't come by itself. It's not just there. And to be involved, you need many factors to work. You need to feel for the, you need to feel for the place. You need to have a belong to the place. You also need to see that there's something for you in this. But we can accept benefits long time in the future. We can accept benefits that come to the next generation. This has been proved. But you must see that there is something for you. And the third aspect usually is that you have to see that the process is fair. You have to know what's happening. You have to have a commitment that's really taken account to. It's quite interesting, in my opinion, right now, that in the buffer zone questions, this perspective comes up. Many of the sites worldwide are now discussing buffer zones. They are required to have them, or they have to review them, or they are not adequate. The whole issue is quite actual right now. And in here, we really pinpoint the ideas about what the values are. You know, buffer zone is not just a cushion, it can also strengthen, enhance the values. And in one of the World Heritage Papers, number 25 on buffer zone, Michael Turner, I think, has a very good kind of a division of different things. He talks about borders of history. We need to see that what that is. We need to need borders of management, what is doable, borders of sustainability, and then the kind of normal views in and out. And on top of this, we also have the intangible view. What is the sense of the place? What, who belongs and who does not belong? And in some sites, which we will listen later, I don't know, Goran is not here yet, like in Scotch and Quays, the buffer zone was something we called, they call transition area. It's a really interesting notion when we're talking about the landscape. And a very new nomination in the Alp region had experience of having the natural resource, you know, a natural site in urban development actually supported the cultural heritage in the urban, in the town, because it provided safety in disaster and risk management, on flooding, an example. And here we also come to the biodiversity issue we have discussed, that perhaps these tools work better than our traditional culture planning tools. Things are going on, things are happening. Networking, I am now in a European Union project of both online training and on-site training with Southeastern Europe. And it's really a way of working together. And of course, in the Mediterranean region, you have Euromed, you have many programs, but perhaps concentrating on landscapes could be a very good idea. And not always having the money or the time to move around and having this kind of, could be a new initiative. I know they already exist, but they have kind of slowed down. There's also World Heritage Capacity Building Project, where YUCN, ICOMOS and ICROM are working together on management, World Heritage Management. And I have participated in a few of them. And it has been quite surprising that it's the first time the natural and cultural heritage responsibles are together and work together. It's a surprise, but it's good that it's going on. And it's been in Benin, Kenya, Bahrain, China, Tunis, it's going on. And it's quite amazing that it's right now, but it fits our purposes very well. So let's use it. Risk management, for sure, it's already on its way. ICROM courses on first aid to cultural heritage in times in conflict is now actually in Rome. But there are also issues, this was the Lebanon forest, which is down there, but there's a lot of things happening around. Cultural landscapes do not only contain one aspect, it's also their surrounding aspects. And in this case, we do have tools which I am not sure we use enough. We also have e-commerce heritage impact assessment, which I have been struggling in practice right now, which also gives us arguments of the impacts. It gives us very detailed checklists of the impacts. And we in our head might know it, but we do not convey it to the other actors who really care about their road. And it can be very useful to use it even in management on your site. Do an overall this one. Can we answer the questions where the changes come? Is it a negligible change or is it very large? What is the values and what's the scale and severity? Aeolians came as one of the issues in the branch, and this is Öland in Sweden. Is the landscape vulnerable? What do they mean? How do we discuss the impacts on this? A very, very hot issue in many countries in Europe right now. How do you work when actually these are a political political declaration to have it, a political priority? And I'm sure we will back to it. But the most important I have found is assessing the cumulative effect, impacts over time. This is also a World Heritage Site in Sweden where the new highway bypass may not be visible from the World Heritage Site, can perhaps be landscaped well, but over time, what does this mean for the sense of the place, of the landscape, of its intangible aspects when a big highway, a big bypass is nearby? This is not unimportant to assess, but we must use different analysis methods. I'm back in the Philippines, as Mehtil mentioned, ecoculture systems. I think there are quite a lot of analyses on this and databases, but not enough. But how do we make it in decision making? Often, they are not mapped. They are no real database to give in decision making. In the Philippines way, it was the first time we draw on a school board, actually the watershed system. And the only legal framework could take on this was the environmental legislation. No culture, no planning, no landscape planning. It was the biodiversity and environmental legislation where we could declare this an environmental sensitive area. I'm sure I will have discussions with this. But I mean, we have to go beyond our table of tools, sometimes beyond our ministries, beyond to find the tool that fits the question. And not just try to maximize the kind of box where we are. Assessing the sense of place. Rio de Janeiro was inscribed now, and actually they found finally the way of the nomination to kind of think about it as a Carioca landscape. It was not the one and the other and history, it was really one word that assessed the intangible meaning of it. And then we went down to look at the attributes. I guess this is the most important one, and it's almost my last slide. Assessing economic benefits. Cinque Terre, cultural landscape. This is a wine viticulteur who can sell his wine for $100 a bottle, but does not get anybody to do the work. Skilled work, it's not interesting. And this is a shepherd in the Pyrenees, which is also nearby here, and he's a highly paid consultant whom you book by internet 1 year ahead, if I'm rough like this. I mean, it's a new economy in the traditional economy, but it has the same aim, and it seems to work. Please, you know more about this than me. Custodianship. This is a new cultural landscape in Sudan, where the custodianship of the site is very clear. It's the local community. It's an extremely well-defined custodianship. How do we support the local community ownership? There was a custodian of every place. Where you come, there was somebody emerging, knowing, inheriting this work, a guardian. And of course, this was the last one I was trying to link on to my Swedish colleague. I also lived in the north in Laponian area for 3 years, I know. Setting the local agenda that is not without conflicts. In Laponia, and I hope we can continue, it's land use rights and international law. Is it indigenous people or an exclusive minority we're talking about? There are three stakeholders, the municipalities, the Same, the Laponian community, and the state. And the conflicts are not to be resolved. You cannot resolve this conflict because the interests are completely different. You have to manage it with priorities. And this is not an easy way. And I'm sure we will talk about it later. And of course, here in the Cevennes, it would be very interesting to hear and what has happened during and after the nomination process. Because that's often when we sit together at the same table and discuss the place. Thank you very much.